No, F you. You.
Means that.
Welcome back to the second hour of Air Checks. I'm your host, Ty Rosenow. The Burkiss Way was a fictional correspondence course comedy that was featured on BBC4 and was originally called Half Open University. It was on the air between 1975 and 1980 with a total of 6 seasons. Here's Lesson 7 entitled Influence, Friends, and People. The Burkiss Way was originally broadcast on December 15th. 1976.
I used to be a illiterate fag. I put it down to coming from a rough neighbourhood. Even as a young child, I couldn't step through a back door without getting mugged, so I had to stay outside. In the Burkiss Way, the dynamic living showed me how even I could appear genteel, refined, and an intellectual genius. All I got to do is walk round everywhere with the Bay City Rollers. Thanks to the Burkiss Way.
It's surprising how people make fun of little things. Every time I went out, everyone used to shout, "Oh, here comes old Four Eyes again." Then Professor Burkiss came up with the answer. Glasses. Now, with special dark glasses, two of my eyes are completely masked, and I look completely normal, except for having two covered-up eyes down one side of my nose and two exposed eyes down the other, thanks to the Burkiss Way.
I used to be a complete failure with men. Every time I tried to get off with a gentleman of my own age, he just walked away. And for years I could never work out why. Then, one day, a friend said, "Listen, Jim, why not enroll in the Burkiss Way?"
Yes, we're back. The BBC's first and only radio show made exclusively for suckers. The Burkiss Way to dynamic living, or you too can have one like mine. Simply send all your money now, plus the name and the address of your psychiatric wing, to Joe Kendall, Nigel Reese, Chris Emmett, and Fred Harris, and any second now, you'll receive details of number 7 in our amazing series of correspondence courses, Influence Friends and Win People the Burkiss Way. Are you unsuccessful in life, bumbling, puny, forgetful, going bald, badly depressed, short of money, inarticulate, overweight, ugly, moronic, impotent?
Yes.
Yes, Eric Pode of Croydon here will tell you that life can be pretty grim if you don't know how to live it properly.
Life can be pretty grim if you don't know how to live it properly.
Thank you. Mr. Croydon, yeah. I imagine it's not easy being stupid, wet, scrawny, and generally repellent.
I find it quite easy, actually.
Well, of course, Mr. Croydon here isn't alone. All over the country there are thousands just like him. In fact, here's one from Bristol.
Good evening.
And here are a party of them from Abergavenny.
Good evening.
Good evening, mate.
Good evening, everybody.
But they don't have to be like that. They do it from choice. If, however, you feel inferior in some way, then allow us at the Professor Emil Burkiss Academy for Academy for Dynamic Living to put matters right.
Using the principles laid down by Professor Emil Burkiss, we can make stupid people smart. And if they don't want to smart, we'll give them some ointment. Above all, our aim is to help you. There's no room in the Burkiss organization for greedy businessmen who are only interested in conning money out of people. I'm afraid we're full up at the moment. But don't just take our word for the Burkiss success story.
It was never any fun for Eustace sunbathing on the beach. It was always the other guys that seemed to have all the fun.
Excuse me. Is anyone sitting on this bit of sand?
Get out of my sight. Get out of my sight, you skinny, repulsive little slug. I wouldn't let my cat spit on you, you gammy, pimply-faced little flower grader. And stop putting that aftershave on while I'm talking to you. Come on, Jane, honey, let's go.
All right, Norman, hang on while I pick up my bikini.
But Eustace had an idea.
Thinks. The big bully. I'll show him. No, perhaps that's going a bit far. Hang on. What's this newspaper? This advert for the Burkiss Way. Gives me an idea.
13 weeks later.
Thanks. Just look at these bulging, rippling muscles. Now I'll try again.
And...
Who's that handsome man coming towards us?
It's me.
But...
That does it. Take that, you abject, pathetic little weed.
Oh, Norman!
Oh, push off, you. Come on, Eustace, you're really my type.
Hey, put me down, what are you doing? Stop handling me.
Yes, another satisfied customer, thanks to the Burkiss Way.
Well, that's an example of what Professor Emil Burkiss can do for you. Starting this week, we're launching a brand new series of radio correspondence courses. If you have a Radio Times handy, turn to page 17 and tear the bottom off. Right? Done that? Good. Now screw it up and throw it away. It's a picture of Eddie Waring.
Now, just send us a stamped address, bank manager, and you're ready for lesson 7, how to influence friends and win people the Burkiss Way.
And first, how to succeed in business without really trying. To see what sort of influence you need to wield in order to rise to the top at work, let's study this next recording of our company's annual board meeting.
All right, quiet, please, ladies and gentlemen, quiet. I now call this board meeting of the Whizzo Dead Rat Company to order. We begin with the company's annual report. Frimson.
Well, in the financial year ended 5476, Mr. Chairman, the accounts for the Whizzo Dead Rat Company show a net profit of £26,572,667.65.
How much is that in dollars?
Naught, sir.
Well, how many dead rats did we sell during the year?
First half or second half, sir?
Both halves.
None, sir.
None? Smuff, you're head of marketing. Why is this?
Because I'm your mistress, sir.
No. I mean, why is there this slump?
Oh, I see. Well, it is a generally recognized tenet of economic science, sir, that there's always less of a demand for dead rats during a recession.
Well, what happened to our sales campaign, Jobs?
We did, like you said, sir, offered a free limb amputation with every dead rat.
Yes.
But it didn't seem to make any difference.
Ah, that's probably where we made our mistake.
Oh, you think so, sir?
Yes, we were far too generous. I mean, good Lord, a whole free limb amputation? People probably thought there was a cache. They probably smelt a rat.
Yes, sir. I think that's what's putting most of them off.
If you'll permit me, sir, I think that part of the trouble is that people didn't actually want a free limb amputation.
What? Didn't want one?
No, sir.
When I was a boy, I'd give my right arm for a free limb amputation. What's this country coming to, for heaven's sake?
Our auditors say it was an error of judgment, sir, making that takeover bid for consolidated dung.
In what way?
Nobody ever actually bought any of their dung, sir. The company never made any profit.
I'm fully aware of that, Smuth.
Well, yes, sir, but I...
Don't worry. I'll soon make this company solvent with this. Our new product. Look at it. It's too unpleasant to actually describe it on the air, but mark my words, it'll go like hotcakes.
Yes, like the dead rats, you mean, sir.
And the dung.
And the free amputation.
Look, are you trying to tell me I don't know how to run a business? Honestly, it's useless trying to deal with you lot. I'm flogging a dead horse.
And not at £77.50 at a time, or not, sir.
I'm not dropping the price.
Look, sir, now why don't we change our approach slightly, sir? You know, try to sell something, well... Nice.
Yes, sir.
Nice?
Well, yes, sir. Why don't we try marketing something that people actually...
Want to buy, sir.
Want to buy, as it were. Yes, sir. Yes.
Sounds like a crackpot idea to me. Still, if you think that... It's a trivial crapnel. Oh, yes, yes. Hello? What? Oh, yes, yes. I'm sure we can arrange that. Yes, yes. 8,500 dead rats. Yes, yes. 16,000 sachets of dung, yes, 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 yes. 473 dead horses, yes, yes, yes. And what? What? Oh, that, yes, yes, yes. Well, we're just starting to market that, yes, yes. I'll put the order through straight away. Goodbye. Oh, saved again.
Really, sir?
Yes, yes. Sometimes I don't know what we do without British Rail catering.
Before we go on, here is an important announcement.
The Burkiss Way wish to apologise to British Rail for that last joke. This was due to a personal vendetta by one of the scriptwriters who was extremely annoyed at being given a cold fried egg at Edinburgh Station, particularly when he had asked for a return ticket to Newcastle. Thank you.
Well, now, how to influence friends. This is quite a simple exercise, but it'll be useful if you get a friend to help you. Stand him up at the other end of the room and try waving at him, preferably using a £5 note.
And always try and look your best when with friends. With a little extra makeup and a slightly lower-cut dress, you could become the focus of attention, as many men have found out. And, of course, don't forget your jewellery.
New from Burkis Beauty Service. Ears pierced while you wait. Teeth straightened out. Hair removed. Apply L. Carlotti and his boys, Sicily.
Well, in a moment or two, we return for a detailed look into the second part of our course, How to Win People. That's after the following intermission.
There will now be a short intermission.
Coming soon, the story of a man who always gets his fair shares. The man who likes to see figures that are nicely balanced and who's never caught with his profit margins down.
Oh, come with me. Mm-hmm. I cannot wait any longer.
No, 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 I cannot.
Not even if I show you both of these?
No. You know, I can never resist the double entry bookkeeping.
Yes, Danish joint auditor on the job. A film that Accountancy Today tried to ban.
Oh, Hans.
Oh, Ingrid.
Oh, Hans.
Oh, Ingrid.
Oh, Hans.
Look, we'll have to check the figures a bit faster than this. What comes after that last oh?
From the people who brought you, I Am Curious, Merchant Banker.
All right, I have done it. I have got into all this rubber. This time, perhaps you won't suddenly lose interest.
Oh, too late, mon amour. Rubber has already gone down 6 points. Let's go into zinc while there's still time.
All right. Give me a hand. Help me.
And the blockbusting Fraulein's Inequitable Life Assurance.
Now, you can't get away until you've had 100 of these. Take that and that and that.
Really, Mrs. Himmler, must you always pay your premium one penny at a time?
Yeah!
Yes, if you need to liquidate your holdings, don't miss Danish Joint Auditor on the Job, coming soon to this intermission.
Another method of winning people is through competitions. Competitions not unlike this one.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of Ask the Clever Dicks. And tonight on Ask the Clever Dicks, we have the Smarty Pants family from Dulwich. And sitting opposite them from Dulwich, an example of real intellectual brilliance, me. Oh, and over here we have the God Doesn't It Make You Sick family who come from Dulwich. Just a reminder of the silly rules. I ask a question and you have to show off. So here we go with question one. Oh, dear. Who first formulated the theory of relativity, promulgated the quantum hypothesis, and conducted experiments of mass and energy?
The Smarty Pants family, Dulwich.
Correct. That's who it was. On to question two. Oh, pathetic. Rearrange the letters of something meaning dull and lifeless to give the name of a comedian.
Dick Emery.
Correct. And the name of the comedian?
Ricky Mead, the Northern Club comic.
Yes, all right. A simple one here for the God Doesn't It Make You Sick family. What's the next number? 2, 3, 4...
8. It's the fourth and final valency figure for the element osmium.
Yes, straightforward one, that. Well done, four-year-old Damien. What's next? Oh, yes, here's a recording of a noise being made from an unusual angle.
Cosmic, genetic, oscilloscopic.
We'd like to have a stab at Esther Ransom.
Oh, very well, here she is. Well done. Now one for the children only. What do you call a man who speaks 53 languages?
Quinto decimo duolingual.
That's 52 languages. Shows these children don't know everything, thank goodness. I'm going to throw this one over to the other side. The God Doesn't It Make You Sick, children. What do you call a man who speaks 53 languages?
Daddy.
Yes, correct. Now, would you all please put on your blindfolds? Thank you. Oh, that's better. Right, you can take them off again now. Now a question... Now a question for the family's parrots. Which parrot can imitate my voice? I see the Smarty Pants parrot has got its light on. Yes, very good. I'll give you 2 points for that. Well, now we come to the last part. Thank goodness. So, everybody, fingers on the buttons in front of you. That's it.
No! Oh! Oh!
Oh! That'll teach you to be so clever. So, with the electrocution spot over, we say goodbye now and I'll see you next week.
Well, as I was saying, how to win people... First, get some people, and then win them. Simple enough, isn't it? But that could be where your troubles begin.
Morning. Mrs. Sprout?
No.
Mrs. Mabel Sprout?
No.
Mrs. Mabel Sprout of 14 Hackney Gardens, Lewisham?
No.
Oh, good.
Why'd you ask?
Oh, just a routine precaution. It's Mrs. Dora Perskins, isn't it?
Yes.
It's bleed 'em dry football pools, madam. I got your prize here.
Prize?
Yeah, third prize in the treble chance, madam. I'll just unpack it for you.
Good evening. Tonight, I want to say, most emphatically...
What is it?
As I've said
before. It's a cabinet minister, madam. Just sign here, would you?
A what?
It's a cabinet minister. Just sign here, would you?
A cabinet minister? But what does it do?
Do? Well, look, it's a member of the government. It doesn't do anything. Look, could you just sign here, please?
Oh, I'm sorry, he's no good to me. He doesn't go with me curtains. Besides, his voice gets on me nerves.
Well, just get him to sit down. That'll soon muffle it. No, could you just sign here, please?
I'm sorry, I'm not having it.
Reconsider.
No.
Oh, please.
No.
Just sign here.
For the last time, put that autograph book away and leave me alone.
I've got it. Use it as a dustbin to dispose of some useless lump of rubbish.
But I haven't got a useless lump of rubbish.
Then you're in luck, lady. I got the Chancellor of the Exchequer in the other crate.
Well, that just about concludes today's course on how to win people and influence friends, and we finish off with a more detailed look at one of our case histories in The Burkiss Way in Action.
And our tale this week comes from the pen of Charles Dickens, a writer which unfortunately never became as famous as its owner. We present The Story of Young Knickertwist Copperby.
My story begins in a strange, rambling old voice. But fortunately, very soon changes.
On a fierce, windy night in November, a young mother and her doctor are struggling to bring a baby into the world. 9 months later, Knickertwist Copperby is born.
No, Mr. Copperby, I do believe it's got your ears.
Pardon?
I was right. Give those back to your father this instant.
Life became bleak, though, when Mr. Copperby died. Young Knickertwist would sit and stare at the painting of his father hanging by the stairs, and then think how well the artist had caught the light on the noose. Mrs. Copperby, however, still had her admirers, one at a time on Saturday afternoons.
Good morning, young man. I've come to see your mother.
She's in bed.
All right, I'll wait until she's finished.
What do you want?
I am Lord Tinsdale, the artist. I've come to finish my work on your mother's bust.
You disgust me. Get out.
Nick, oh, there you are. I've the most delightful news for you, Nick. You know Sir Wensley Partington?
He comes round every morning, doesn't he?
With the help of some strong coffee, yes. Well, Nick, you'll soon have to start calling him Father.
Oh, that's marvellous news, Mama.
Oh, I knew you'd be pleased.
He's becoming a priest. That means we won't have to put up with a miserable old faceache round here anymore.
Knickertwist, if you and he can't get on, I shall have to send you away.
Away, Mama?
To school, Nick. To do the boys' hall.
Mama.
And to do the boys' hall, young Copperby was sent. He soon became terrified of Wackford Squeers, but he got on quite well with the rest of Wackford's staff.
Copperby, come here.
Yes, sir.
Where's your homework, Copperby?
It's at home, sir.
Don't answer me back, boy.
But Mr. Wackford, sir...
Don't call me names either. And don't speak with your mouth open and take your feet off the floor. I'll soon wipe that skin off your face. Hold out your hand.
Oh, no, sir. No, sir. Anything but that, sir.
Don't be a baby, Copperby. Hold out your hand. That's better now. Where's that saw?
No, sir.
In a week, Copperby had stood as much as he could, until he had his feet sawn off as well, and then he fell over. But eventually he ran away to seek fame and fortune in the cobbled streets of London.
If you please, miss, I'd like to get to Peckham.
How dare you take that!
Oh.
Here. Can I be of assistance, my dear?
Yes, sir. If you please, sir. I, Knickertwist Copperby, am all alone in this great city, looking for shelter. and completely at the mercy of the first hideous-looking Jew who grabs me for his gang of young pickpockets.
Ah, good, good. In here.
Oh, what's this dingy, greasy hole?
That's my mouth, my dear. Now then, Copperby, my dear, I should say you are just the person to help out a poor, deserving old gentleman.
Yes, certainly. Where is he?
Such a sense of humour the young man has, hasn't he, Nancy?
I'll say, Sugan.
I think I ought to go. My mama didn't approve of me meeting lots of strange men.
What makes you think that?
She always kept her bedroom door locked.
Well, we are as straight as dies, aren't we, Nancy?
Do me a favour, Fagin.
Later, my dear, later. Now, Copperby, I want you to play a little game. I just want you to play a little game, my boy. Listen to what young Smudger over there says and note it down on this piece of paper.
Very well, sir.
Right. What's the difference between a buffalo and a bison? You can't wash your hands in a buffalo.
Yes, very good, very good. Did you write all that down, my dear?
Yes, sir, there we are.
Excellent. I think you have the makings of a good one, Copperby, my dear.
A good what, sir?
Shh! Ah, it's you, Dodger. Any luck today, my dear?
I've done my best, Fagin. Here.
Oh, let's see what you've got, let's see. My wife's so fat she kick-starts jumbo jets. Excuse me, madam, your husband's been run over by a steamroller. I'm in the bath, sleeping under the door. Do you file your nails? No, I throw them away. Yes, lovely, daughter, lovely, lovely. All nice and old and completely untraceable. All the better for his purpose.
For whose purpose, sir?
That would be telling, Copperby, my dear.
Yeah, Monkhouse would murder us. Sorry.
Monkhouse. So that's it. This man is paying you to go around the city stealing jokes for him.
Shh, Copperby, my dear. Too much knowledge isn't good for you. I shall send you out now on a job. And to make sure you behave yourself, you'll be accompanied by Miss Betsy.
Who's she? Some common trumpet, I'll bet.
I think you mean strumpet. Strumpet, Copperby, my dear. A trumpet is a rather expensive, brassy thing that doesn't take too long to pick up. And you finger it at one end. Betsy! Come in here a minute.
Hello, Fagin. What is it?
Mama!
Nick!
Mama! You, operating in this den of vice... I might have known. All my life you've thought of nothing but men. Every time I see you, it's with some man. I'll bet you even went with one before I was born.
Oh, Nick, just give me one last chance. From this moment on, I'll do everything I can to mend my ways.
But tragedy was to intervene. Three years later, young Nickertwist Copperby's mother was lying in the local church cemetery.
Oh, Mama! Why did it have to happen? Why? Why, oh, Mama? It's not fair, Mama. Oh, Mama!
Yes?
Mama! Will you leave the vicar alone and let the poor man get on with his funeral?
Do you find things get on top of you at funerals? Do you find it impossible to get on with women? After just 2 weeks of our course, all that could be reversed. You'll find it impossible to get off with women. Apply now to Joe Kendall, Nigel Reese, Chris Emmett, and Fred Harris, care of the Burkiss Way, Stepney. Andrew Marshall and David Renwick will write you a script under a special money-back offer. If not completely satisfied, you simply send us some money back. Addressed, please, to producer Simon Brad of Stepney. See you next week, suckers, and happy dynamic living!
That was The Burkiss Way. ZPPR Productions of New York City produced a series in July 1987 for the public radio called Visit New Grimstead Anyway. The comedy showcases the hijinks of the inefficiency of the government.
And everyone who enters the I Love Vinyl City contest will receive their very own fur-lined pepper mill, embroidered with the saying, New Grimstead, Vinyl Capital of the World. It's nothing to sneeze at. Coming up on 11:15 here at New Grimstead Radio, The Voice of Vinyl. Broadcasting high atop the municipal building. Remember, this afternoon we hope to bring you a live interview with Neil A. Hoffman, former professor of public administration at Blatt University, and the new director of special services, newly appointed by our new mayor, Miriam Vargas. I'm sure he'll be glad to share some of his new ideas for New Grimston. Now, before we get to the news, a musical selection from our Sounds of Nature series. Filbert's Mating Call Sonata for flute and emu.
Hello, lobby. This is the lobby. The lobby of the municipal building. The lobby of the municipal building in New Grimston. No, lady, we don't have pork fried rice. This is the lobby of the municipal building in New Grimston.
Excuse me, guard. I wonder if you could help me.
Mister, does this look like a Chinese restaurant?
No.
You're damn right it don't. So, now, what can I do you out of?
My name is Neil A. Hoffman. Could you direct me to the Office of Special Services?
Room 1959.
Wow, had that right on the tip of your tongue.
That's the year my wife left me.
Oh, well, thanks a lot.
Hold it. Let me see your pass.
Pass? Oh, yeah, here it is.
This is no good.
My pass is no good. Why not?
It's a blue pass.
So?
Today's Wednesday. That's a red day. You can't use a blue pass on a red day.
But look, it's stamped by the building flow supervisor.
He don't come in today. It's a red day.
So what do I have to do to get in?
You gotta get a red pass.
Who do I get a red pass from?
From the building flow supervisor.
But he's not in today.
You catch on fast.
Hey, look, I'm Neil A. Hoffman. I'm the new director of special services. I've got to see Mayor Vargas.
The mayor? Why didn't you say so? Then you need a special mayoral pass.
I've got one. Here.
This is no good.
Why not?
It's not stamped. You gotta get it stamped.
And who do I need to stamp this?
The building flow supervisor. Excuse me. Hello, lobby. No, lady, we don't have pork fried rice. This is the lobby of the municipal building in New Grimston. No, we don't deliver. Now, look, son. Hey, where'd he go? He snuck past me. Let me have Mr. Banner in security. Mr. Banner, this is Walter in the lobby. There was a guy here. He got past me into the building. I don't remember his name, but he said he was going to special services. What do he look like? You can't miss him. He had a blue pass.
New Grimston, a thriving city, a living organism. Its subways and highways are the veins and arteries through which the red corpuscles of its population flow, bringing much-needed nourishment to the businesses and industries that are its liver, kidneys, and spleen. And at the center of this urban entity, its local government, controlling its bodily functions through a complex array of nerve endings, the mighty brain of this great city, reaching out with many tentacles to encompass.
Skip it. Visit New Grimston anyway.
Zipper Productions presents Visit New Grimston Anyway, an intimate look at how a big city is run. Really.
18th floor, watch your step.
I guess you think 17 and 3/4 is enough.
And the horse you rode in on, lady. Watch the doors.
Aren't you ever cheery before lunch, Andrea?
I was cheery, Brian. You must have blinked and missed it. Come on.
Oh, Andrea, you're just angry because the mayor herself authorized this public relations campaign. You people at budget don't like to spend money.
Brian, when it comes to a 30-foot-high billboard over the mouth of the mid-city tunnel showing Mayor Miriam Vargas standing with her feet planted wide, her hands on her hips, and saying with a big gap-toothed grin, "Welcome to New Grimston, vinyl capital of the world," I feel the money could be better spent. Like on false teeth or chickens. Let's go.
You just don't understand good salesmanship. If you... Ooh.
Hey, watch where you're going, you jerks. Neil? Brian, it's
Neil. Hey, Neil, it's your first day here, right?
Andrea, Brian. Well, that's right, my first day. Hey, Brian, Andrea, remember?
Black University. Fly high, you bombardiers of black, through the clouds of white. Knock that competition flat with a mighty splat, and fight. Though the going may look rough, it's got as tough as stuff up here. So rough them up and scuff them up, and don't take any guff. Go black, you bombardiers. Bombardiers. And black.
Well, that brings back memories.
Also, breakfast.
So, Director of Special Services.
Yeah, Brian, and wait till you hear all the ideas I worked up for this place.
Haven't changed since college, huh, Neil?
Brian, he's one of us now. Welcome, Neil, to the building of Lost Souls. Woo!
Woo yourself. Let me help you pick up all these papers.
So what happened to that teaching job at Blatney?
Well, after Kimberly and I got divorced, I wanted to do something different. This special services offer from Mayor Vargas sounded like just what I needed. A challenge.
Yeah, Brian, you know about special services.
Yeah.
Woo! What about special services, Andrea?
You'll find out.
What do you mean? Hey, what is this stuff you dropped? Down is up. Down is up?
It's Mayor Vargas's idea.
Yeah, Her Honor, the mayor is making Down is Up the cornerstone of a young and vibrant administration. Yay.
It's a new PR campaign.
Well, look, Andrea, can't you see Mayor Vargas just wants to turn New Grimston around, revitalize the city? Nothing wrong with that.
Down is up, Neil?
Well...
What does that mean?
That's what we're trying to find out at the PR meeting, Andrea.
To which we are still late, Brian. I've got everything. Come on.
Right. Let's get together after work, Neil.
Wait, I've got to see the mayor. How do I get there?
Two flights down.
But don't forget, Neil, down is up.
Down is up. Ooh.
Banner, security. No, I'm with somebody. Then I'm going out. I'll be back here in my office at 1320 hours. Well, Walter... I'm disappointed in you. You let the municipal building down. You let the team down. You let me down.
But, Mr. Banner, this lady calls up and orders pork fried rice. And
Walter! Walter. For want of a nail, Walter. For want of a nail.
But, Mr. Banner...
Walter! Loose lips sink ships, Walter. Well, Walter... It looks like I'll have to take the ball and run with it. You say our man had a blue pass?
Yes, sir.
And you're sure you heard him say special services?
Yes, sir. Said it was his first day on the job and that he wanted to see the mayor.
Good. Don't take it too hard, Walter. You're young.
I'm 57.
Young in spirit, Walter. Well, I'm off. And remember, Walter.
Yes, Mr. Banner?
The price of freedom... is eternal vigilance.
Beautiful. When you talk, Mr. Banner, the angels sing.
Yes?
Neil A. Hoffman is here to see you, Mayor Vargas.
Show him in. Now give him a chance, Ms. Roebuck.
Mayor Vargas!
I may even give him two.
Come in, Neil. Have you seen the building, Neil? What do you think?
It's, interesting. Mayor Vargas, I wanted to talk to you about some ideas I have on the...
Glad to hear it. We'll get you settled in this afternoon. We've arranged for an interview with you in the new Grimston graphic.
The graphic? But why not a paper with some integrity? I mean, the graphic? I'll probably end up between the prune pit killer and a story on graft in the disposable diaper industry. I mean, their idea of responsible journalism is to dress up their interview subjects in gorilla suits.
Neil, may I introduce Elizabeth Roebuck, political analyst for the graphic?
Delighted.
Oops. I'm sorry. I meant that...
No need to apologize, Mr. Hoffman. Having the power of life and death gives one great tolerance.
Oh. Mayor Vargas.
Yes, Neil.
Let me just say I've got lots of ideas about special services and how I'll fit in with the team.
Good. We'll talk about them very soon.
Well, I thought we could have lunch.
Sorry, not today, Neil. They rescheduled the ribbon-cutting ceremony at the waste disposal plant, and they assure me it won't back up this time.
But I...
Since you're free for lunch, Mr. Hoffman, why don't you join me? I can start to uncover a few things about you.
Meaning?
That's a fine idea. But before you go, I want you both to have one of these buttons.
Thank you, Mayor. Mine's a little loose.
No, no, they're supposed to turn around on the pin that way. You see, down is up.
Oh.
It's a great idea for getting my slogan across to the public. Don't you think, Ms. Roebuck?
You'll have no problem, Mayor Vargas. With a little well-placed help.
I know I can count on your paper's support, Ms. Roebuck. May I speak to Mr. Hoffman privately for a moment?
Of course.
Mayor Vargas, I'm sorry about the gorilla suit remark.
Don't worry about it, Neil. I just want to remind you to make a good impression on Elizabeth Roebuck. She can do a lot for us. She's very powerful.
So I gather.
I'm counting on you, Neil. Off you go.
Thank you, Mayor Vargas. Gorilla suit. Dumb, dumb, dumb. Where are we going to lunch, Miss Roebuck?
Luther's Municipal Tavern, I think. It's around the corner. A bit rapish, but things tend to happen there.
Excuse me, sir. Can I get through?
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go, Miss Roebuck.
Please call me Elizabeth. It's a much more promising way to start.
Can I help you?
Banner, security. I'm looking for an intruder. He was carrying a blue pass.
of genie with the light brown hair. Come on, Roscoe. Got that desk, Roscoe?
Yes, Uncle Mickey.
Now you just rest your transistors here, Roscoe. I'll see if we're in the right place.
Yes, Uncle Mickey.
Yes? Oh, hello, Uncle Mickey.
Hello, Miss Brownlow.
Hello, Roscoe.
Hello, Miss Brownlow.
Is this the office of that new fella, Hoffman?
Oh, yes, Uncle Mickey.
Is this where I bring the desk?
Yes.
You want the desk inside the office?
Yes.
Can't do that.
Oh, dear, why not?
The desk is 2 inches bigger than the doorway.
Couldn't you take off the legs and move it in, and then reattach the legs?
Oh, no. Desks are Class B equipment. Can't tamper with Class B equipment without authorization.
Oh, dear, what can we do? Mr. Hoffman will be here this afternoon.
Tell you what I could do, Miss Brownlow. I could knock a few feet out of this doorway. Of course, then you'll need a wider door.
Could you just rebuild the doorway once the desk is inside?
Oh, no. You need a Class 7 permit to build. Zoning board, city council. Pretty complicated.
Oh, dear.
Let me just take some measurements and see what I can do. Got that tape measure, Roscoe?
Yes, Uncle Mickey.
My, a robot like Roscoe certainly is a help, isn't he, Uncle Mickey?
Sure is. Ever since that boiler blew up back in 73, I've been able to build a whole bunch of improvements into him. Last week, I put in a hot lather dispenser. See? Nice and hot.
My, that's remarkable.
The measurements, Uncle Mickey. The desk is exactly 2¾ inches wider than the doorway.
Well, I guess I gotta knock out that doorway. Got that sledgehammer, Roscoe? Stand back, Miss Brownlow. Don't want to mess up that pretty hairdo with the flying brick.
Here's the sledgehammer, Uncle Mickey.
Here goes!
Hey, what for you get so quiet? Just because I dropped goulash? Nobody got killed. I like to hear noise in my restaurant. Talk! That's better. Oh, Miss Brobuck, I'll bring your coffee in a minute, yes?
Thank you, Lubo.
So, this is Lubo's Municipal Tavern, eh? I don't mean to be rude, Miss Roebuck, but this is not exactly the place for quiet conversation.
Don't be deceived by Lubo's heartiness or by his establishment. A lot of deals are made here. And Lubo is Lubo.
And down is up. So, Miss Roebuck...
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, when are you going to ask me about my ideas on special services? I really think I have some great...
I'd like to get a feel for my subject first. For instance, what size gorilla suit do you take?
I really am sorry about that, but you seem so poised and cultured.
Like a pearl?
I can't imagine you working for the graphic.
Hey, Nico!
What do you want?
Put the wine in the pot!
What's the matter? A slug for them, a slug for me! A slug for them, a slug for me!
The graphic, Neil, is the Bible of the rank and file. It's such a wonderful feeling knowing that a thought of mine, an opinion, a whim is being implanted into 500,000 heads every morning, and they pay 30 cents a head for the privilege.
You know, I read that power like that corrupts.
To pander to the masses, one need not join them. And don't pontificate, Neil. It doesn't become you.
Me?
Pontificating indicates a desire to appear powerful.
What about you?
That's different. I am powerful.
Coming through without coffee. Watch your foot. Move it or lose it, lady.
Ah, Miss Roebuck, your coffee. Sorry it took so long. I had to milk the beans. Coming! Excuse me. I have to go to the kitchen and wrestle with a clam.
Keep your apron on, Nico. The place ain't cold enough.
Ms. Roebuck. Elizabeth, I get the feeling you aren't really interested in my ideas on city government.
Of course I am. Didn't you write a book on the subject when you were teaching at Blatt University?
You've heard of my book? Fiscal Management Problem Solving in Contemporary Urban Civic Structures?
Is that the thick one?
That's the thick one. Good as a doorstop and for use in hand-to-hand combat.
I must remember that the next time I argue with Malcolm. The spouse.
I know, Malcolm Hewlett, publisher of the graphic.
Are you equally afflicted?
Married, you mean? I'm divorced.
I'm sorry. Should I be?
I guess. I don't know. Look, about my ideas...
Oh, I am sorry, Neil. I have another appointment.
But...
Besides, it's almost 1 o'clock.
What happens at 1 o'clock?
Hey, Nico, it's 1 o'clock. The jukebox, eh? All right, everybody, sing. Hey, you sit down and sing. Ha 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 ha.
Does this happen every day?
He's closed Sundays.
Yes, Mr. Banner. The intruder? No, I haven't seen him again. No, Mr. Banner. One second, Mr. Banner. Let me see your pass.
Here.
This pass is blue. Don't you know? Hey, wait a minute. You're the guy from this morning. Where are you going?
I told you, I'm new here, and I'm going to my office.
Yeah, but how'd you get out of the building?
Out?
You got by me once without the right pass, but not twice. Get back in the building. Go on, get in.
But I...
Go ahead, get in. Move.
Well, all right.
Hello, Mr. Banner. I just saw him. Yeah, the guy with the blue pass. Don't worry, I got him back in the building. What? Well, he got out without a pass, so I... Yes, Mr. Banner. Yes, Mr. Banner. I struck out at the bottom of the ninth in the seventh game of the World Series with the bases loaded. Does this mean I go to the farm team, Mr. Banner?
19th floor, watch your step.
Thank you very much.
Did you say thank you? I don't believe it.
Let's see. Room 1959 must be down this way. 1955, 1957... Wait a minute. This room has no door. And the door frame's smashed in. And there's plaster all over the floor. And there's a boiler blocking the way. This is my office. I'd better move this boiler and find out.
Are you Neil A. Hoffman?
The boiler is talking.
If you are Neil A. Hoffman, please push the button.
Shaving cream? Well, it's nice and hot.
Not that button. The red button. Hello, Mr. Hoffman. I am Roscoe. I am designed and built by Michael J. Magoo, a member of the New Grimstead Municipal Building Custodial Staff. For a message from Michael J. Magoo, please press the red button when you hear the tone.
Jeez.
Hi, Mr. Hoffman. This is Uncle Mickey. Sorry about your door. Had to get your desk into the room. Oh, and sorry about your desk legs. They don't build Class B equipment the way they used to.
It is my office.
Not to worry. Roscoe has been programmed to guard against vandalism. Try and take something. Go ahead. Try it.
I don't believe... Okay, I'll take this doorknob on the floor.
Please don't take that doorknob. It's not your property.
Where's the off button?
Ain't that just dandy? And if you want to shave, the blue button will give you shaving leather that's nice and...
Get out of my way, Roscoe, you hunk of...
Who's there? Is that you, Mr. Hoffman? How do you do? I'm Miss Brownlow, your secretary.
Nice to meet you, Miss Brownlow.
Well, we're all honored to have you working here, Mr. Hoffman. And your book is very famous. The thick one.
Yes, the thick one.
Oh, well, I guess you've heard about your desk and, the door.
Yes, I have, Miss Brownlow. Could we have a little more light in here? Is that the switch?
Well, no, Mr. Hoffman. That's a dummy switch.
Dummy switch?
Why, yes. In some of these older offices, people keep breaking the light switches. So they put the real switches where people can't get at them.
So how am I supposed to get at it?
You have to call the custodial staff.
Could you do that for me?
Certainly. Hello, custodial staff? Yes, I'll hold.
Whose picture is this on your desk, Miss Brownlow?
Oh, that's me, Laura Lee Brownlow, the first Miss Vinyl.
You look very pretty in that picture.
Thank you. I wore a lot less then.
Well, I'm going to look at my desk, Miss Brownlow.
Oh, hello. This is Miss Brownlow in room 1959. It's a little dark up here. Could you turn on some more lights? Yes, I'll wait.
Ah, who turned on the sprinkler?
Hello? No, it's not brighter, but it is a lot wetter.
Don't you love the way the air smells after a spring rain, Mr. Hoffman?
Yes, but not in my office, Miss Brownlow.
Oh, Mr. Hoffman, I almost forgot. You had a phone call.
Yes?
It was Miss Tibbett.
Miss Tibbett?
From the radio station upstairs. She wants to see you right away.
Me?
Oh, you'll like her. She's the current Miss Vinyl.
What does the current Miss Vinyl want?
Peace and understanding for all mankind.
No. I mean, what does Miss, Tibbett want with me?
She said you were supposed to talk to her, and that you should hurry.
Well, I better go up then.
Oh, and take your umbrella, just in case.
You reckon skipping, Tabitha?
Oh, well, I, for one, never realized you could get such tone from common kitchen utensils. It's coming up on 3 o'clock on New Grimston Public Radio, the voice of vinyl. We'll be back, but first this public service announcement.
And now you have 30 seconds, Tabitha.
Hey, Eddie, that last record was a bit on the edge, you know?
Someone's outside your booth, Tabitha.
Come in.
Hello, I'm Neil Hoffman.
Oh, hello, Mr. Hoffman. Come on in and close the door quickly. Please sit here, Mr. Hoffman. Get this close to the mic. There, that's right.
Mike, what?
And don't say any of the words printed on this card. Not allowed on radio by the FCC, you know, especially number 4. My name is Tabitha Tibbett, Mr. Hoffman. Don't call me Tabby. It gets me mad. I'll call you Neil.
You're on, Tabitha.
Hello again. This is Tabitha Tibbett, and we are indeed honored to have with us Neil A. Hoffman, the new Director of Special Services, here to discuss all the various projects he's working on.
Are we on the air?
Of course we're on the air, Neil. But tell us, what are some of your ideas for all of us here in New Grimston?
My ideas? You really want to hear my ideas?
Oh, if you'd be so kind.
Well, I don't know where to begin. Well, Tabitha, I have a proposal to use the abandoned North Railway Terminal for a computer education center that will cut
costs
by...
Excuse me, Neil, but that terminal is scheduled to be torn down next month.
Oh? Well, Tabitha, another idea I have is to modify the community billboard program to include...
I'm sorry, Neil, but that program is no longer budgeted.
They cut the budget?
Oh, they needed the money to tear down the abandoned North Railway Terminal.
Oh, I...
What else?
City Charity Drive?
The Interfaith Council does that, Neil.
Are you sure I can't use any of the words on this FCC card? Number 4 looks really good.
You can't go in there.
Let me in that studio. Let me in. I've got clearance. Banner. Security.
Could you step up to the mic, please? About this far. And don't say any of the words on the printed card. Especially number 4.
Oh. Banner. Security. Are you Mr. Hoffman?
Yes.
May I see your pass? We believe you are the man who infiltrated the building under false pretenses this morning.
Pass?
You don't have one, do you?
I
thought not. You've been clever, Hoffman. But I've dogged your every step, and now I have you.
Now look, I work here.
Then where's your pass?
Here.
Let me see it. A blue pass.
Well, that's the pass they gave
me. A likely story.
And we have a caller. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, this is Walter, the guard in the lobby. I was listening to your program down here. Can I speak to Mr. Banner?
Go ahead.
Yes, Walter. What is it?
Well, Mr. Banner,
spit it out, ma'am.
Well, I just found this memo from the building flow supervisor. It was under my lunch pail.
Yes, Walter.
Well, it says that a Neil A. Hoffman would be coming in with a blue pass with a little gold star on it. I guess I had my thumb on the little gold star. Mr. Banner, do you have the pass?
Yes, Walter.
Lift up your thumb, Mr. Banner. Mr. Banner, is it there, Mr. Banner? Is a little gold star there?
You
is
may
it?
Hang
All
up,
All you
gotta
do
Ms.
is lift
Tibbett.
Up your thumb. It's this little
Thank
gold
you for
star.
Calling.
It's right there.
All right, Hoffman. Very cagey.
Me?
But I'll be watching you.
Stay on mic, Mr. Banner.
I'll be watching you. Watching for you to slip up. And you will slip. They all slip.
Well, we're out of time. Stay tuned for the news. This is Tabitha Tibbett saying, in the rocket ship of life, the fuel is you. Good afternoon.
Good show, Tabitha.
Thanks, Eddie. Well, thank you, Mr. Hoffman. That was fascinating. And what lies ahead for you?
Lubos.
Well, young fella, you must like my place. You're back again.
Yeah, I'm back.
Let me fix you up with my special drink, a vinyl blowtorch. You're gonna like it. It makes funny noises. Hey, Nico, get the rocks off.
Funny noises. Well, I could use a laugh.
There he is, Brian. Hello, Neil.
Oh, hello, Andrea. Brian.
I see Lubo's pulling out the rock salt.
Tough day, Neil?
Municipal building.
It's only your first day, Neil.
That's just it. I mean, already today it's been... This is not the way I imagined it.
Well, Neil, you're used to the tidy academic life. Things aren't always like your book. You know, the thick one.
Yeah, that's what we're calling the miniseries.
Neil, it's...
Look, Andrea, I walked in this morning full of ideas. I was going to make New Grimstead's government work.
Was that before or after you ended world hunger?
Yeah, well, first I can't get into the building, then I can't get out of the building. They turn my office into a war zone. I get rained on. I get all my ideas trashed on radio in front of the entire city of New Grimstead. I miss vinyl. And on top of that, I almost get arrested for trespassing.
Slow day.
What am I supposed to be doing here?
You're a repairman, Neil. Something doesn't work, the mayor sends you in to fix it. Everything you've been complaining about, you've been appointed to help clean up. You wanted a challenge? You hit the jackpot.
Watch your foot, watch your foot. Here we are, young fella. A vinyl blowtorch. Don't touch the glass, it's hot.
Thanks.
Hey, I saw you come in, Miss Pergolesi, Mr. Weinstein. Here are your regulars. Your whiskey sour.
Thank you, Lubo.
And a warm beer for you.
Is it flat?
Of course, Mr. Weinstein, just the way you like it. Hey, Nico, put down that fish!
A toast, Neil.
Ow, that glass is hot.
Welcome to the municipal building.
Ooh. Our cast featured Paul Singleton as Neil Hoffman, Mickey Frumpkin as Mayor Miriam Vargas, and Sarah Montague as Elizabeth Roebuck. Also heard were Henry Enberg, Susan Rice, Thomas Gansevoort, Nancy Sweezy, Raquel Barbizon, Andrew Joffe, George Czar, Dory Nash, and Tim Cowan. This episode of Visit New Grimstead Anyway was written by George Czar and Andrew Joffe and directed by Andrew Joffe.
That was Visit New Grimstead Anyway. Stay tuned in the next hour when we will be welcoming you to the Museum of Everything and the news at bedtime.